Anthony Guthrie here for your journey to PA school, and I'm joined by my good friend Brian Palm. I'm so lucky to have him here. We're doing a face-to-face interview. You know Brian from myPAresource. He's an ERPA in Georgia, and the fact that the two of us are sitting together in this room to film this interview is just so awesome.
Worlds collide.
Thank you
for
coming.
About time, definitely. I'm happy to be here. Yeah.
Great to finally meet up and do this interview.
Absolutely. Long time coming.
You have such an amazing backstory and kind of journey to how you become a PA, and you're so successful with your entrepreneurship and things that you're really doing for the PA profession. It's just blowing my mind, and kudos to you for all these amazing things. But let's kind of start at the beginning. When did you realize that you wanted to become a PA?
Yeah, so I appreciate the kind words, first of all. So I first realized I wanted to be a PA. It wasn't until, you know, long after I had a lot of experience, like within hospitals and working on an ambulance as an EMT. I knew since I was little that I wanted to help people. I had to repeatedly go to a doctor when I was in middle school. And so from that kind of point on, I thought, hey, I want to go be a doctor. I want to help people just like my doctor helped me. And so, you know, through high school and then into college, it was always in my mind I was going to be a dermatology physician. And I had my whole, you know, where I was going to go to school laid out and everything. And then college, of course, hit me like a slap in the face and realized that I had to support myself and kind of work full time while I was in school to help pay for school and everything else. So unfortunately, like with that, I'm sure a lot of applicants know, you know, when you're working full time and being a full time student, sometimes your grades suffer. You've got to kind of, you know, restructure your priorities and figure out, you know, what you need to put more focus on and when. So my grades kind of suffered a little bit, kind of in the middle of college. And so I didn't know what I wanted to do. You know, I figured that my grades weren't good enough for medical school, and so I knew I wanted to help people. I knew I wanted to do something, but I just didn't know. And so at one point in time, I thought I wanted to go work in a lab as a microbiologist. And so I took a microbiology course. I actually majored in microbiology thinking that I would love it, but I finally worked in a lab my senior year of college and was miserable. Absolutely hated it. Yeah. So then I was back at square one. Like, I still knew I wanted to help people. Got my bachelor's degree in microbiology, and then I went to EMT school because I figured, hey, as an EMT, I can help people. And then working on the ambulance, I got kind of interested in emergency medicine, and then eventually got a job as a like an ER tech as an EMT, working in an ER. Got exposed to PAs there and kind of learned what the profession was about, and said, hey, this is exactly where I need to be. So
nice. One of the great underlying characteristics of being a PA is adaptability.
Definitely,
so the fact that you kind of learned as you went during undergrad and realized, hey, you know, I need to adapt and kind of move into a different position to really find something you enjoy. And it's funny you bring up the story about thinking microbiology lab and working there and realizing you hate it. Similar situation for myself. I was on track, basically physical therapist, my whole undergrad, doing kinesiology, sports medicine, going to work in physical therapy. Ended up working at a physical therapy clinic to gain some hands-on experience and realize, you know what, it's just
I mean, that's why, you know, as an applicant, like trying to get into the PA profession, like and applying to school, that's why experience is so important. That's why these schools put so much focus on shadowing PAs and, you know, interacting with them and trying to figure out like what it's about. Because, you know, you might apply to PA school, hear that it's a great job and all this, and then eventually realize that this isn't really what I want to do. And so that's why it's important. I know that you kind of communicate that with your followers and everything, but, you know, it's about getting as much experience as possible to, you know, make sure this is what
you feel that the EMT really helped you, especially as far as being an ER tech?
I think so, yeah. So as an EMT, I got to, you know, I learned how to start IVs and, you know, take vital signs and all that. And just, I think the most important skill that you can learn with jobs like that, like as an EMT or a CNA or an MA or any other kind of positions, you know, not necessarily entry level, but just, you know, kind of a step above to get your foot in the door, is how to interact with people. You know, and that's an important thing about gaining experience, is that the more patients that you interact with, the better that you're able to communicate with patients. And, you know, so much of patient care is based on, you know, how you make a patient feel just based on your interaction. And so, like, as you know, I mean, a lot of the time patients just need to be listened to and, like, make sure that they're heard and make sure that their concerns are addressed and all that. And so, I don't know, I feel like even though I had a huge, you know, diverse range of different experiences before I was even an EMT, but all of that just kind of played a part in kind of helping me. And I think that's why I like the ER so much, is just because I get to interact with so many different people.
Yeah, it's ER is so fast paced. There's always something new coming through the door. You don't know what to expect. You're always on your toes. So that's great. Yeah. Leading into you, right prior to you applying to PA school, did you happen to shadow any PAs?
Yeah, so most of my shadowing came from PAs that I worked with in the ER. And so the ER that I worked at, I worked at an ER outside of Atlanta. It was a trauma center. And so I was stationed, per shift, I was stationed in one certain area, but the PAs would kind of flow all over the ER, taking care of patients everywhere. And so I wasn't you know, necessarily following one PA. I would work with docs, and a lot of the time it was, you know, working with nurses, because mm-hmm. the PAs and docs would be, you know, in and out and taking care of other different things while I'm, again, like doing vital signs and kind of transporting patients and all that, just typical ER tech stuff. So my shadowing came from actually reaching out to PAs and be like, hey, can I come and shadow you for a shift or two or three, right. And then kind of learning firsthand like what their job actually entailed. So it's great. It was great as an ER tech to, you know, get to see PAs in action, but it wasn't until I really shadowed that you get that one-on-one and like actually get exposed to what they're doing.
Shadowing is such a vital aspect to helping you decide if the PA profession is truly for you. So that was great. One of the other things you brought up, you mentioned seeing the doctors and the nurses and how they all interacted in the ER. And I'm a firm believer, a lot of people say, well, I just need to shadow PAs. And I believe you actually should shadow people in all different backgrounds and experiences and different professions in the medical field, because it opens your eyes to their role in medicine and truly the PA profession and medicine in general. It's the team aspect.
Yeah.
And with you being able to see the nurses and interact with them and see their role in the physicians and the PA and how they all work, I think it really helps you develop and become a great PA.
Yeah, no, I think you're exactly right. And that kind of goes back to the same thing that we were talking about earlier, is that get as much experience working in various different, you know, jobs and roles before you apply to PA school, just because you want to make sure you're getting into something that you're going to want to do the rest of your life.
Right.
You know?
It's a big commitment, a lot of work, a lot of effort, heartaches that go into it. So you want to make sure you know what you're getting yourself into, putting in all that effort. Now let's kind of fast forward a little bit to the time where you start applying to the PA programs. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did you get in on your first time applying?
I was unbelievably lucky that I got in my first time. So I applied to, I think, 13 schools. I didn't even fill out all the supplemental applications that I needed to even qualify as applying to those schools. So in CASPA, I submitted to 13 or so. I filled out supplemental applications, I think, for 5 or 6. So, you know, 6 of those applications were down. Like, completely pointless of me applying. And then so I filled out supplementals for 5 or 6 and then got interviewed at 2 and then accepted at 2.
All right,
so
perfect.
Yeah, I was very fortunate. I know people that have applied for, I think, 5, they got in their 5th try.
Mm-hmm.
So it's tough, but I don't know how I did. I wouldn't be able to get in now, I don't think. I would still be an EMT.
I think you got the work ethic.
Yeah,
I think
that's right. Yeah, maybe so.
Where you attended PA school and what year you graduated?
Yeah, so I went to South College in Knoxville, Tennessee, and I graduated in 2013.
You just wanted to erase it from your mind. So hard and difficult. He just wanted to erase it from his mind and not even think about how he's done.
Well, I graduated. We graduated in December, and so I technically graduated in 2013, but I didn't start working until 2014. And so technically, I've been a PA almost 5 years, but it's just right at the end of the year, so it's tough to.
Gotcha. Now, knowing what you know now and looking back, what would you do differently while you're applying to PA school? Is there any specific thing you would have liked to do differently? Or?
I would have not applied to schools that I didn't really have interest in going to. And so my situation was that I had a lower GPA, and you know, some people that are watching may know, you know, my GPA was sub 3.0. It was a 2.93 or 2.93 undergrad and 2.97 after my post-bac courses, cumulative GPA. And so I was applying, really, I was almost like desperate, because I just applied to any schools that had a minimum GPA under 3.0.
Mm-hmm.
Because I knew I wanted to go to PA school, and I was just really thinking, all right, well, I'm going to go anywhere. But I guess that's kind of contradictory, because I didn't finish the applications on 6 anyway. But yeah, so I would have looked more into programs that actually fitted my goals and my aspirations, as far as like their mission statements, where they were. I applied to schools that were way out. I applied to a school in Connecticut. I have no family up there in the Northeast, just because they had a lower GPA requirement. But I think it's important to go to programs or schools, look at them in a way that, you know, you want to make sure that you have a support system that's, you know, close, that you're able to, you have friends there or family or something. Personally, you know, the last thing you want to do is move across the country somewhere where you don't know anybody, and then you start a program where you're, you know, studying all day, every day, and not have anybody to really help you through that. Now, you know, I was very fortunate. Classmates of mine, former classmates of mine that are some of the best friends I have, we still keep in touch and everything. And they were really important in you know, helping me through school, but I was also close to my family and friends and everything too. So, right. So I would look at more schools that are, like I said, closer.
You bring up a couple really good points. One, you kind of did what I call the shotgun approach. You just sent out applications everywhere because you met the requirements.
That's pretty common, yeah.
And that is common. In hindsight, you realize that probably wasn't the best thing. Some people go to the point where they're actually just throwing money away because they're applying to schools that they have no interest in. They might not meet the requirements when they think they do, so you're just throwing money away. And applying is really expensive, time-consuming, and stressful, so you want to make sure you really kind of hone down your top choices, things you think, programs you really think you could get yourself into, and apply to those. But now we all know that didactic year is really stressful, but what was your favorite part of PA school?
I mean, looking back, PA school was one of the hardest things that I've ever done, and I'm sure that you can attest to that too. It's 2 years of just nonstop studying and committing and sacrificing almost everything in your life, just about. You know, my fiance then, who's now my wife, and she was great throughout the entire process. She understood like my priorities and everything. But my favorite thing about PA school is probably just getting to know my classmates. Getting to learn and get prepared for this career that I have no doubt that I'm going to spend the rest of my life, you know, practicing. So it really is an honor. And I remember getting through PA school and just finally making it through and being able to associate myself with the people that I had looked up to for years before being able to do that, you know. And so being able to do this is it really is like, it's just a blessing.
Yeah, it's a wonderful profession. You can tell both he and I truly love what we do.
Yeah.
And we're just so thankful to be a part of this field.
Would not do anything else.
Yeah, same thing. People ask me, would I be doing something else? Would I want to move on?
And you want to go to medical school?
Yeah, that's like a common question from patients and then other people. Like, when do you start medical school? Like, nope, this is it. This is an awesome profession. I enjoy every bit of it. But you kind of touched base on you're in a serious relationship during PA school.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of people have the question of, you know, how is it when you're married in PA school or have serious relationship, the time commitment, things like that. So maybe you could briefly touch on work-life balance or basically school-life balance and how did you work around that?
Yeah, so, you know, my wife and I guess you could say that we really practiced me having us not spending a lot of time together. She went to the University of Georgia and I went to the University of Tennessee, and so we dated for a couple of years before you know, PA school, and so we were used to not seeing each other but once a month, once or twice a month. So so when the time came when I had things that I had to do, or there were things that she had to do too, you know, when I was free and she had things to do with her work because she was a teacher, it's just about like mutual understanding and respect and communication. I mean, communication is so important with anything, and like PA school or not, it's so important to, you know, the person that you love or the person that you are, you know, committed to is supportive of your goals. Because clearly, PA school is not something that is like, you don't just do it on a whim. This is truly a commitment. And so I think that it's important just to remain open and stay, you know, keep communicating about what you need. If there's something that, like if your significant other or spouse is, you know, kind of pressuring you and kind of taking away from your studies and making things harder for you, I think it's important to talk about that and kind of, and rather than just let it, you know, fester and become a bigger problem. But as long as I think, you know, the two, like, you know, the person that's in PA school and the significant other are on the same page, I mean, you can do it. People do it all the time. I had classmates that had kids in school.
Right. Yeah. Same with me. I had classmates that married kids. Some people had young children, teenagers. So there's just a wide variety.
I mean, and life happens. You know,
communication is definitely key. Yeah. I think if they truly understand all the effort that you're putting in to achieve your goals, you know, if they really love you, they're going to help push you and motivate you to achieve your goals because they want to see you succeed, especially if they're truly, you know, caring individual that wants to see you do well in life.
Yeah, it's important to be with somebody, I think, that supports you, like you said, in your dream and your goals. So,
So didactic year is just you got to slug it out, working in the trenches, you know, studying all the time like crazy. But then you get to clinical rotations.
Yeah.
And you think, this is so awesome. I actually get to do stuff. I get to do all the things I learned about in my That's right, books yeah. and all the things I got tested about, and then reality hits you in the face, and you get your white coat, and you're like just scared to death the first time you have to walk into that room to see a patient. At least that's how I was. Yeah. But maybe if you have a fun story or experience you like to share with everyone about clinical rotations.
Yeah. So my favorite memory from clinical rotations is the first time I got to intubate a patient. I just thought that was so cool, because you know you're literally saving somebody's life. I mean, this person is unable to breathe for themselves, and you are helping them with that. Another awesome thing about clinical rotations that I got to do is I had an elective rotation in cardiothoracic surgery. And so I had the opportunity to go in during a CABG, which is a bypass basically for somebody that's got coronary artery disease. And I was in there, I got to hold the heart as it was beating, and the cardiothoracic surgeon was sewing on bypass grafts. And I mean, that stuff like that is just incredible, and like stuff right. I would never get to do again. Mm-hmm. You know, cardiothoracic surgery personally is one of the coolest fields that a PA can work in, just because, I mean, there's nothing cooler than that to me.
I think clinical rotations, one, it opens your eyes to just all the amazing things you get to do as a PA, but then it makes you appreciate just everything in medicine and how fragile life is.
Oh, yeah.
Makes you appreciate all the little things we take for granted in regards to our health.
Yeah, I remember after the first clinical rotation, everybody came back for their end of rotation exams, and everybody was kind of talking about, everybody came from different specialties that they had worked in. And just listening to everybody talk, and when we do scenarios and everything, like, it started to click, like, oh, we do actually know things. Because mm-hmm. you go the entire didactic year, 12 or 16 months sometimes, and, you're ready to get through it and just kind of be done with it, whatever. But then you get out there, like you said, and it's kind of like, I don't know if I know what I'm doing. But it turns out that you actually do. The sacrifices that you have made have actually paid off, and you actually do know, something. Not all things, but something.
Yeah. Medicine is just too vast. You're not going to know it all. You're going to have fear of the unknown. You're always going to be second-guessing yourself. But with time and experience and practice, you build up your confidence and you start realizing you are truly helping these patients and helping these people. So it's just an amazing feeling.
Yeah.
Now, did you get into working as an ERPA right after PA school?
I did, yeah. And so, like I said before, I worked as an ER tech before as an EMT. And so after I got through school, I did a clinical rotation at my at the hospital that I worked in the ER before I went to PA school. I did my ER rotation there with a doc that I had worked with previously. And then when I got out of school, I threw an application out there and was like, hey, I'm ready. This is what I want to do. And they kind of warned me because it was a trauma center. It was one of the busiest in Georgia. It was ranked nationally one year as far as busiest, top 50 busiest ERs in the nation. And the docs told me when I came that, like, you get one shot. I don't know if you want to get some experience doing something else before, but you get one shot, you sink or swim. And if you sink, there's no second chances. And so that was a nice kind of welcoming, warm feeling when you
get that. Pressure's on.
Yeah, but it worked out, I kind of thrive with that sometimes, I feel like, when things are more stressful and, mm-hmm. I'm forced to make things work. I did. There were days when I didn't know what the heck I was doing, but I did, and I'm very fortunate that my school, my PA school, prepared me so well, and like I said, I love what I do, and it's a great job, but I'm very lucky that I got into the ER right out of school, because some people don't. Some people have to do the fellowships or other things too, but I got into the ER right after school, so.
One thing I think you hit perfectly was the fact that the sink or swim aspect of it. But I think what really PA school does, so a lot of people ask me about PA school and like, what are they supposed to teach you? What should you know? And really, I truly think that a good PA program is going to teach you how to handle stress, how to think under pressure, how to find the resources to do well and succeed. It's not about how well you could do on a test. I know they all want to have like perfect 100% pass rates, first time pass rates, but the true essence of a PA program, at least in my book, is to prepare you to handle the stresses that you're going to endure as a PA, and to think critically, on your feet, logically, and be able to handle things that come through the ER. So you're coming through trauma, crazy accidents, gunshot wounds, and you're able to take a step back, think about it, logically understand the steps, and I think that's truly what the essence of a good PA program.
Yeah, I think you're right, and even more on a personal level too. I think as a new grad especially, but even as a PA now, I mean, I'll admit if I don't know something, you know, it's as a PA, you have the benefit of having a collaborating physician working with you, and so if you have questions, like, you can't be afraid to ask that. I think that's important for PA school, PA students to learn too, is that it's okay to not know things.
Right.
You know, as long as you have an idea, as long as you can kind of think about, you know, like keeping a wide differential list and thinking about what it could be, like really bad, you know, worst case scenario type things. But as long, it's okay not to know. I mean, I think that's so important to teach. Like, you're not expected to know everything at all times. Even docs have to ask each other, like, you know, things, so.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What are maybe a couple key pointers or tips you could give to people out there trying to write their personal statement?
Yeah, one of my main things is, it should be common knowledge, but it seems like every other personal statement, it's not every other, that's dramatic, but a lot of people in their personal statements still write physician's assistant. Mm-hmm. And so it may sound ridiculous that, you know, well, I know it's physician and not a physician's assistant. But I can tell you, I've been in interviews where we had students, then we read over their essay right before we interviewed them, and it says physician's assistant, and I'm telling you, like, it automatically, you know, cuts you down a notch. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's so important. Like, even if it's a typo, even if you know it's physician assistant, just don't put physician's assistant in your essay, and that's kind of a given. But another common thing I see is that people seem to be kind of preoccupied when they write their essays about explaining kind of where they struggled and like bad semesters that they had and why, and kind of providing excuses as to what happened. I think it's okay to talk about your struggles, but I don't think you should do that like right after your introduction or at the beginning of your essay. I think, you know, you need to keep in mind that the purpose of this essay is to communicate why you have decided again to pursue this profession, and I don't think it's a good idea to, you know, give an introduction and start off with a story about when you interacted with a PA or something medically that happened to you or something that you witnessed, and then go right into my sophomore year, I didn't, you know, give school the attention that it deserved, and, you know, I mean, it's a terrible transition, that, you know, but two, I mean, it's important to stay the course and focus on the purpose of the essay overall. I mean, you want to talk about why you want to be a PA, and if at the end you have space, you want to talk about, you know, areas that you struggled and what happened, I think it's okay to do that. But two, also keep in mind that, you know, a lot of the times in supplemental applications, they give you an opportunity to say, tell us about an area that you struggled, or is there something that you want us to know that you didn't put in your personal statement, or, you know, something else. I mean, you'll likely have an opportunity at some point to explain that. But if you, I think you should, like I said, focus primarily on why you've decided to become a PA.
So I appreciate your time and all the valuable insight that you've provided for everyone out there, but I like to do something at the end called drop some knowledge.
Okay.
And so I want you to think of just like one key piece of advice you'd like to give aspiring PAs out there.
Some of the earliest advice that I got when I was in middle school, and so when I first decided that I wanted to become a doctor, or we'll just say like wanted to, you know, pursue a career in healthcare, and my uncle is a neuroradiologist, and he doesn't live close to me, but we would see him at, you know, holidays and everything, and he told me when I told him that I was going on this path, he told me, when you work hard, but when you play hard. And you know, I think that, and you know, with that comes, I think, boundaries, and you have to limit yourself and everything. But I think it's very important to focus on your goals and where you're wanting to go, but also take time for your mental health. And so if you're studying all day, every day, not doing anything that you enjoy, if you enjoy studying, more power to you. But if you're overwhelming yourself with, you know, keeping your nose in the books and not communicating with friends, family, not, you know, taking breaks and stuff like that, I think that you're not setting yourself up for success. Now, granted, some people can you know, bust through that and keep working and keep going hard like that. But I think it's very important to give yourself a break, because I mean the path that you're on is not easy. It's going to take a lot of sacrifices, but I think it's important to kind of keep things that you enjoy, you know, open and you know, make sure that you're able to do stuff like that every once in a while.
That's some great, powerful advice. And Brian, I want to thank you again for taking the time out to meet and let me interview you. Just amazing story. and so fortunate to have this time to hang out and meet up. And until next time, guys, I can't wait till the day to call you a fellow PA. Thanks.
Amen.
Yeah.
See.
You nervous back there?
No.
You shouldn't be nervous.
You're just excited?
Yeah. It's recording now.
Your trade secrets.
There's no secrets.
you have so much knowledge and background experiences, Rita Mora. I'm sure you just have so many.
Yeah. I need to write a book or something.
Yeah, you could write your book on how to write personal statements. That's for the next video. We'll interview on that.
There you go.
But